So first of all, I didn't do any magic, right? I did get an empty class. Yes, go ahead.
Isn't there a shorter way to...
There may be, but this one is... what did you think was the shorter way? I don't even know.
It seems like you're getting SG and then you're clearing it and then you're getting it again, whereas
possibly.
If you do both of the THs...
Yeah, I should have done a better version. That's a good point. Okay, so let's keep that in mind, but... So I'm just going to replay this. It's one set of inferences that I got did until I got an empty class. Okay. Then I'm just going to count the number of resolutions I did. Okay. Because you have to start thinking of what I'm doing as search, and I'm just showing you one path in the search tree. In a minute, I'll show you the search space itself. And the number of resolutions I do is the depth of the search. And you know how bad depth is, right? Because B power D will be the space in which you are doing the resolutions. So I'm just showing you one path that works. And this guy says there's actually a shorter path, so that might be possible. Okay, in which case it'll be a shorter proof. And there'll be two interesting questions that we'll have to consider, which is, do you care? Do you care about the shortest proof or not? Or you just care about empty class? You just want an empty class. I would argue that really what you need is an empty class. That's it. So in fact, if you think of resolution inference as a search procedure, okay, the length of the path doesn't matter. Of course, the math people will say this looks like a machine proof. It's not elegant. We won't publish it. Who the heck cares about them? We just basically need to get through to see whether the fact that we are trying to prove is actually provable or not. Do you understand what I'm saying? The length of the proof is not connected to anything like true cost of execution or anything. So the number of steps in the proof doesn't really matter. All that would matter is, in fact, this kid is saying that I'm inelegant. So you can see what his grade is going to be. But the point is that it doesn't really matter. If I can get the empty class, I'm fine. Okay, so let's see how many resolutions I did. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So this is a 7-depth solution. And it's possible there is a 5-depth solution. It doesn't matter to me. Because both solutions are equally good. Because I don't care about the path cost. Do you see what I'm saying? So even though we started with A-star search as the search, here is a different kind of a search. It is sort of falling in the same idea as A-star search, except we don't care about the path cost anymore. As long as you can reach the goal, which is goal condition is just the empty class, we're done. Okay, now, so is there search in the inference? Well, if I show you a path, you would be fine. But to get that path, then you must have looked at all other paths too. Okay, and then basically there is indeed a search, and you need to make sure that you're not doing the same thing again and again and again. Yes, sir.
So just to clarify something about resolution. So the resolution rule basically says that, like, in order to combine two sentences or whatever they call it,
two clauses,
they have to be something or something and something or something.
Yeah, no. Basically, the most general statement of resolution is, you can say, A1, R, A2, R, A3, etc., AN, and then followed by not AN, R, B1, R, B2, R, BN. Okay, then I can just remove AN and not AN and write A1, R, A2, R, etc., up to AN minus 1, R, B1, etc., up to BN. That's what resolution is.
Okay, so just in the case of, like, say, GW, like uh-huh. the very first resolution we did, GW uh-huh. and not GW or R or SK, I mean, wouldn't we have to somehow expand GW to get it in the form of GW or something else?
So this one, what are you saying here? GW, so basically a clause is, this is a clause, GW or something. the something is normally, what is the something? Can you write A to be A or something?
False.
A or false, yes. Okay, so, no, I'm sorry, A or false, that's true. Okay, so basically all I'm doing is GW and not GW are gone and there's nothing left here and that's RSP, RRSP, that's all I'm just writing. Okay? Any other question? Okay, so the question that I was asking just before I left, just before you asked that question is there search? Yes, there is search. I just showed you one path. If you want to write an algorithm, you have to write an algorithm such that it carefully does pairs of resolutions until it finds an empty graph. And it needs to sort of arrange that search in such a way that it would essentially keep track of what resolutions it did so that it won't keep on doing the same resolutions. Okay, it's cute to actually see how the search here differs from the search in normal A star search. Okay, in particular, we didn't care actually about the length of the solution. We did agree with that, okay? So I will show you the search in resolution, which sort of looks like this. Essentially, you start the database into a classal form. Think of that as a DC, it's like a set of classes, okay? Then you negate the goal first and then convert into a classal form. That will be a little database of goal classes, DG. Then you start with the initial database of DC plus DG, which is the set of classes, some of which are from the goal and some of which are from the knowledge base. Now you loop, it's a nice big loop here. Select a pair of classes from the current database, DC plus DG, resolve them. Whatever you get, add it back to the database. And keep doing this until you actually find that the resolution happens to be empty class. Yes? Haunt classes?
You have to.
No, all you care about is you have to get an empty class. This is why it's worth hallucinating empty classes. That's why people hallucinate empty classes. You know, if you can somehow find an empty class, you're done. You don't have to use everything at all, after all. In fact, the tricky thing is to be able to use just the right set of classes to show the empty class. And it's not obvious. Okay, one of the other interesting things is actually that you will see in a minute. Basically, a large number of theorems can be proved. What you want to prove is empty class. What is provable versus what is relevant to your situation can be two completely different things. Okay? It may be you can prove many, many theorems, but they're not useful to what you're trying to prove. Okay? Actually, since I said that, I have to tell you my Sherlock Holmes jokes. So many years back, BBC has run this competition for the world's funniest joke. Okay, and so they gave, I guess, some big database of jokes, and people had to vote the funniest jokes, and people had to suggest, and I think some other people voted. And the following joke was voted to be the funniest joke in Britain. There is a different joke that was voted funniest in the US. We'll talk about that later. But this is the Sherlock Holmes and Watson joke that was voted the funniest, and it's relevant to what we are talking about. So Sherlock Holmes and Watson go on a camping trip, right? And then they basically spend the whole day, I guess they're hunting, they do this stuff, that stuff, et cetera, et cetera. And then finally in the end, end of the day, they have their dinner, they have their wine or whatever. They pitch the tent, and they go to sleep. Okay, in the middle of the night, Sherlock Holmes takes up Watson and asks Watson, tell me what you see and what you can deduce. By the way, you do have to understand that Sherlock Holmes is the patron saint of logic, right? Because if you read any Holmes, it's all about deduction. What can you deduce? Right? Okay? So Sherlock Holmes asks Watson, what can you deduce? And so Watson basically says, I see stars, I see clear sky, I see this thing that the fact that there are stars and there's a clear sky means that there may be some atmosphere above us, but there are no clouds, this, that, and he's making large number of deductions. Okay, and also the fact that the stars are nicely in formation means there is some cosmic force that is putting them in that formation. He's making this beautiful set of deductions, and he, you know, after about an hour or so, you know, Holmes says, "What's the new idiot? This means that somebody swiped our tent." See what I'm saying? Things that can be proved versus what is useful to prove are not one and the same. Everything that Watson was saying is provable, but it is provable. But it's a useless thing to prove. The most important thing is, why the heck am I able to see the stars when I'm in the middle of the tent? Okay, to me this is like the most relevant joke for what we are doing, because you will be able to do a large number of resolutions. The one that you care about is the resolution that leads you to the empty class. So don't be Watson, okay, if you're trying to prove this. But obviously, it also shows that, you know, many, many things can be proved, but what is required and what is relevant is a different issue. And that's why the search comes. Okay, so there is a bunch of resolutions that are going on here. It looks like a search tree. You're basically taking states of classes and resolving them. You need to somehow make sure that you don't keep on doing the same resolutions again and again. Plus, you also might want to do some heuristics. You may want to reduce the number of resolutions you do while still saying that if there was an empty class possible before, you can still get the empty class. You see what I'm saying? Now, it turns out that, first of all, I'll show you how full search looks like, and I'll show you two heuristics. The word heuristic winds up having a slightly different connotation here, because path cost doesn't matter. All you are saying is to reduce the number of resolutions. The question then is, admissibility of the heuristic would mean if it was possible to get an empty class before, with the heuristic, will you still get an empty class or not? That comes back to your question. I might be using a heuristic which reduces the number of resolutions I have to do, but it might make deeper set of resolutions to get the empty class. You see what I'm saying? The total number of resolutions that it will search through is reduced, but it might find the empty class with a deeper set of resolutions. Which is fine, because I'm doing less amount of search. And I don't need the shortest proof, because nobody gives me a badge for providing the shortest proof. Okay? So, let me show you how the search looks like. Basically, think of it as, in the beginning, I write all the classes and the goal class together, okay? And then the first level resolvents. In the first level, basically, I just take a pair of resolvents above that level, pair of classes from above that level, and resolve them, okay? So those are all the resolvent, the new classes. Now at the second level, I will take one class from the previous level and one class from all the previous levels. So one class from immediately previous level, and the other class from all the previous levels. If you do this, you can be sure that you have never done the same resolution more than once, because you're at least making sure one class is new. You realize that? Okay? So that's what is the second level. And third level, you make one class to be from the second level, the other class can be from the first, second levels. The initial, first, and second levels. This is how the search provides. Goes. And if you do this, this is the full search space. If you do this in this particular order, if there is a shortest proof, you'll find it. Okay. But now I want to see if I can avoid doing some of the resolutions and still get an empty class when an empty class is possible. Do you see what I'm saying? There are interesting heuristics for that. I'll tell you two heuristics, both of which reduce the number of resolutions I have to do. One is actually admissible in the sense that if there is an empty class, it will still find the empty class. That means if it was provable, it will still be able to prove it, even though you're not doing some of the resolutions. The other is not. Okay? And then I will make a connection to prologue, which will make it much more interesting. Okay. So, one idea is what's called the set of support strategy, which is what I was sort of talking about when I was doing the resolution previously. I said I'll make the reasonable assumption that the original knowledge base itself is not inconsistent, and that the inconsistency is coming because of the goal being added to the knowledge base. And so I will make sure that every time I'm doing a pair of resolutions, one of the pair of the classes would be either the goal class or something that came from the goal class. So you define this notion of set of support classes in this recursive way. Every class that is a goal class, that means it came from negation of the goal being converted into the class L, it has set of support. Any class, one of whose parents is, at least, has set of support, also has set of support. Do you see what I'm saying? Now, as long as you only do the resolutions that are between one class which has set of support and the other class is anything, you can clearly see that you are doing only a proper subset of all possible resolutions. Because you are avoiding doing resolutions between two classes, neither of which have set of support. Right? You reduce the number of resolutions. And yet, if you just use set of support resolutions, you can prove that set of support is a complete strategy. That means if you could prove the theorem before, you can prove the theorem now. And that's because you're basically making sure that, you know, if there's a negative empty class, it's coming, you know, you're using the goal class as one of the pairs. Okay, now if I'm using set of support, which actually is what I did in the previous chart, you know, if you look at the previous example, I did every one of my resolutions for set of support. Okay? Because I started with GW and I resolved it with this, I got this class. Since GW is a goal class, it has set of support. So anything that was resolved from this also has a set of support. My feeling, if I'm not mistaken, my feeling, the reason why this guy thinks I could have done something simpler is he would say, maybe let me do this kind of a resolution and SG and not SG will go away. Something of that kind. And if you do any of those, you could potentially reduce the depth of the resolution, the depth of the trace of the resolutions. But those would be non-set of support resolutions. So if I were to do just not SG and this, I don't know whether that was the case, but if I were to do this, which I can do the resolution of, that is still a resolution, but that doesn't have set of support. Yes, sir? You did have a set of support one? Good. That's nice. So obviously, I didn't do it right. Okay. But it is clear that everything I did was set of support because I'm basically picking one of my classes is always the red class. That's the way you know it's a set of support. Okay? And you can see that set of support resolutions will certainly be complete. That's one idea. The other idea, and that's complete, so that actually shows the set of support one. So basically, you notice that a resolution is always being done with one of the goal classes and a class from anywhere else. It's not very clear here, but in the previous example, it's clear. One of the classes is always a red class. And the original goal class is a red class, and everything that's derived from the goal class is also a red class. Another idea is called linear input form strategy, where you say every resolution must use one class from the original input set of classes. Do you understand what I'm saying? So nothing, you don't resolve between two derived classes. You always resolve between one input class, original input class, and one of the derived classes. This looks like a very reasonable idea. Very, very reasonable idea. In fact, Prolog does that. Prolog, by the way, is a theorem prover. I don't know if you realize that. And Prolog does that. But it turns out that is incomplete. There are theorems that can be proved that you will miss if you do linear input form as the heuristic. So instead of admissibility in A star sense, we talk here about completeness of the heuristic. And what the heuristics are doing is reducing the total number of resolutions that you have to deal with. And then the other issue, of course, is that you notice that I didn't particularly care in this about making sure that things have to be done in depth-first fashion. I can do depth-first traversal, which might give me longer proof, but if I still get an empty class, I'm still done. Okay, so this is sort of useful to see the same theory of search that you learned from A star search is slightly different application here. Because here the length of the solution doesn't matter. All you care about is the empty class at the end. Okay? Okay, and then the next thing, of course, is the matches for the empty class. I already mentioned this. So remember a couple of these. This is more like, you know, the kinds of mistakes you don't want to do. It has nothing to do with the theory of logic. This is everything to do with how not to screw up in a midterm. Okay? So you must definitely have everything in CNF classes before you can resolve. That we agreed. Okay? And furthermore, the goal first must be negated, and then you convert into the class alpha. So first you take the knowledge base, you take the goal, and then negate the goal, now convert the whole thing into class alpha. That's what you do. Okay? And you have to remember that goal, original goal, might get converted into multiple classes. You have to realize that. So for example, if I wanted to prove something like A and B, then I negate A and B. Oh, sorry, wait. No, if I want to prove A or B, okay, then I negate A or B, it becomes not A and not B. Not A and not B becomes two classes. Not A is one class, not B is another class. So in the previous example, there was the beginning, there was only one goal class. But in general, there can be multiple goal classes to begin with itself. They'll all be red. And if one of your parents is red, then you will be red and you will be a set of support class. Okay. And the other thing is, this is the one I told you, resolution works for resolving a single literal and its negation. So don't fall for this. PRQ is resolved with not PR, not Q. Every year somebody, despite what I just said, despite people acting as if they are paying attention, I'm pretty sure one of you will do it. You know, so don't do it. Don't be that person. So PRQ cannot be resolved with not PRQ to get you an empty class. You are dying to find an empty class, but that's not the way to get it. Okay. So one thing, you know, is that the inference complexity, I already mentioned that the model theoretic propositional inference is co-NP complete because satisfiability is NP complete and entailment is unsatisfiability. And so show that it is not satisfiable. And so it's just co-NP complete. Okay, resolution is a sound and complete procedure. That means it will do everything and exactly just that thing that model theoretic entailment does. That means resolution refutation procedure is also co-NP complete. Right, because it's an equivalent problem. Okay, so resolution refutation is also co-NP complete. And that typically basically means that most algorithms that you will find are exponential complexity in the worst case in the size of the initial database. Exponential complexity in the size of the initial database. Okay? There are happy special cases. If it turned out that when you converted everything into a knowledge base, into a classal form, they were Hahn classes, then in that case, the worst case complexity would be polynomial. Okay? In a sense, basically it turns out that if they're all Hahn classes, essentially they're just a, it's off. In fact, Hahn classes, another big reason to be very interested in Hahn classes is again Prolog. Prolog is full of Hahn classes. How many of you know Prolog? Some people did say, yeah. Prolog is just Hahn classes. Okay? Because you're writing classes of this type, A and B implies C. Of course, Prolog is also predicate calculus, in the sense it has predicates with arguments. But if you take the propositional version of Prolog, then it is actually just Hahn classes. Okay? So A and B implies C, A is true, B is true, and you try to prove C. This is what Prolog does. It's just that what you normally write is, if I remember, I hate Prolog. that's what you do. Right? You can prove C by proving A and B. Okay? And in fact, what Prolog is doing can be seen as resolution refutation. In fact, there's a particular form of resolution called SLD resolution refutation. That's what Prolog does. So you are actually understanding Prolog here, even though you don't see it. Okay? If you put predicates there instead of propositions, then it's basically Prolog. And then it turns out that since you are essentially considering clauses of this type, they are all turn clauses. Because A and B implies C will be not of A and B or C. Not of A and B because not of A, or not of B or C. At most one positive positive literal is need allowed. You have exactly one positive literal. You're fine. You never have Prolog sentences of this form. A and B implies C or D. If you do that, then Prolog would not be harmed, because A and B implies C or D is a propositional sentence. But if you take negation of A and B or C or D, it will be not A or not B or C or D. More than one positive literal. Prolog hates that. In fact, there is an entire different area called disjunctive logic programming. My old graduate school roommate actually did his thesis in that area, disjunctive logic programming. Okay? But Hahn class theorem proving, it turns out, is going to be polynomial complexity. Those of you who are putting things together in your head might be wondering, how can you combine the fact that Prolog is supposedly doing Hahn class theorem proving and that Prolog is Turing complete programming language? If you don't, that's okay. If you do, come and talk to me, because you're actually awake and putting things together. It turns out the other things, there are other things that Prolog does about, over and above this, such as it has the cut operator and such as the fact that it does negation as failure. So that's the other very interesting thing. Prolog typically, to prove, to prove not A, it tries to prove A, and if it fails, it says not A is true. And I said that's not actually allowed in first order logic, in logic. Right? Just because you couldn't prove a fact doesn't mean you could prove the negation of the fact. Do you remember that? I just said that. Prolog basically proves something, a negation. It proves negation by failing to prove the positive. And that actually doesn't make sense, you know, in normal logic. Okay? But those things and a couple of other things make Prolog actually Turing complete. So it actually does allow you to write every possible algorithm. Okay? But let's leave it at that. Okay. That's about the complexity. And I already said that if you were to go to first order logic, things will break down, and then actually the worst case complexity will be semi-decidable. Okay, here it's only going to complete, and this is the last time you'll be that happy. Okay, so in the remaining, well, how many minutes do I have? 5 minutes?
Three
full minutes? So 3 minutes, I will speak extremely fast and complete 2 more chapters. Okay. Well, what can I do? So I do want to actually just mention this, and maybe I will send you a link to this problem called satisfiability problem, which I did mention that I'll talk about earlier. So the idea, what about satisfiability problem? If I give you a set of classes, notice that if I have any arbitrary propositional knowledge base, I can convert to a set of classes. So if I give you a set of classes, a satisfiability problem says, find the truth-falsity assignment for all the propositions such that all classes evaluate to truth. Do you see what I'm saying? And basically, not being able to find any such assignment means it's unsatisfiable. And if you use a satisfiability prover to prove that a knowledge base is unsatisfiable, then you can use it as a theorem prover. The interesting thing is, while we actually just basically passed over satisfiability to go to entailment, satisfiability by itself has a beautiful set of applications. It falls under a chapter that we just skipped over called constraint satisfaction problems. And in general, you know, given a set of constraints available for the available classes and your class requirements, find a class schedule for you. That's a satisfiability problem. Okay? Given a chessboard, place 8 queens on it such that no pair of those queens will conflict. That's a satisfiability problem. Okay? Given a Sudoku board, solve it. You remember Sudoku? That used to be like a big deal for a while. Satisfiability problem. Given a digital circuit, verify that it works as advertised. Otherwise, you would be Intel that, you know, with the Pentium chip. I don't know. Every year people are becoming younger, so you may not remember this. But Intel once had a Pentium chip, which once in a while made mistakes. They thought it was like a 99% correct, but you care. And then, of course, there was a huge public relations failure, and they had to actually redo the whole thing. So how do you make sure that a complex logical circuit actually does the right thing? It turns out that you can write it as a satisfiability problem. So even though we passed over satisfiability problem, the satisfiability problem is by itself a very interesting problem. And I want to just show you this slide and we're going to go on. Okay? So the idea is that if you have a set of classes like this, this is like a party problem. I'm trying to get a party with a set of these people. Okay? And the constraint is that either Joe should not be coming or Tom should not be coming. Otherwise, it will be a bad party. Okay? This is sort of an XR situation. And then either Tom should be coming or Mo should not be coming. And then either Joe should not be coming or Mo should be coming. These are my party constraints. You know, imagine you're trying to, you know, make a party and you're deciding which subsets of people just don't get along at all. Okay? And then you need to come up with a set of people that you're going to invite so that you'll have a successful party. That means all these constraints have to be satisfied. So finding, you know, an assignment for Joe, Tom, Mo, which are, you know, such that it will be basic, all the constraints will be satisfied, is a satisfiability problem. And it turns out that you can write it as an extremely simple search problem. And this is connected to one of the true-false questions in the first exam. Because you would start with a search problem where each level is a variable. Joe is the first, let's say, first variable. And then it can be either true or false. And then after Joe, then you pick another variable, Tom. That can be true or false. After that, you pick another variable, Mo. That can be true or false. And there are actually only three variables. So essentially, in this search tree, there will be exactly three layers. So it's a finite search tree. And where will the successful parties live in this search tree? At the leaf level. Because you need to know for each of them, are you going to invite them or not? All successful parties live in the leaf level. Dead parties might live higher up, but successful parties all live in the leaf level. Furthermore, since all the parties live in the leaf level, depth first search is just as good a search strategy as anything else that you ever studied. So constraints are